Shaitanir Rajim, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. You are all welcome to another edition of our online class. And today, inshallah, we shall be looking at the theory aspect of our mock examination as we have did look at the practical section in the last lesson. And I hope by now you should be with your question paper, with your script, so that you can see where your error lies. But before I go ahead, I'll first make a general observation about your answers in that exam before we begin to look at the specific area we need to point out as regards each question. The general observation I have is that, one, you tend to have forgotten what you have learned in the first 2 years in the senior class. And as I have been saying in the normal class, that you cannot escape what you have done in the past in your exam. So as you read the current work you did, you should also try as much as possible to revise back those things you have been taught in your SS1 and SS2. The second observation is that it's not how lengthy you have written an answer that will earn you your full mark, but the most cogent point in that particular answer you have stated. And I implore you again to pay a rap attention as we go over the little parts of this theory section we shall go through in this class today. So the first question has to do with explain the term commercial farming. Commercial farming is a type of farming system which has to do with production of crops and animals on a large-scale production. So you know, what will make you score that full mark is that large-scale production and for sale. That differentiates it from the other type of farming system we have been look at, which is subsistence farming. If those keywords are missing, that answer is not correct. B, state one function of each of the following parts of a mudboard plow. We have looked at the plow, we have looked at the component parts and what their functions are. And part of those component parts is what the question have asked you to state the function. The first one is the inch. The inch, if you did remember, there is a kind of coupling point. At times we call it the inch or the coupling point. And the function of this inch or the coupling point is to allow you to attach the plow to a tractor. Because the mudboard plow is a coupled implement. And where you are going to couple it or attach it to the tractor is the point of the inch, the furrow wheel. If you look at the wheel, the function of the wheel, the furrow wheel, is to give balancing effect to the mudboard plow. This cut here is to make an horizontal cut into the soil. Then the mud and the plow shear to make a vertical cut and uproot the weed. And lastly, the mudboard, what it will do is to turn over the soil and infected the root. Remember, this cutter has uprooted the root. In order to expose the root of the weed, in order to kill the weed totally, the root has to be upward. And that is what the mudboard will do. It will do the two things together. It's going to turn over the soil and also expose the root of the weed. And those are the few component parts of a mudboard. We still have other ones. C part. Outline three ways of replenishing plant nutrients in the soil. If we have cultivated our crops, the soil is bound to lose nutrients. And we have looked at in the class effects, ways of replenishing lost nutrients in the soil. And what are those ways we have mentioned? One, we mentioned crop rotation. We mentioned organic manuring. We mentioned inorganic manuring or fertilizer application. We mentioned liming. We mentioned bush fallow. Any of these will end your 3 full marks. D part, state 4 economic factors affecting land availability for agriculture. Where this question also comes out has to do with the uses of land in agriculture. And there are two ways we can use the land, either for purpose or non-agricultural purpose. And that's where this question is generated. That what are those economic factors that will now affect land availability? Note here. The question, what we did look at is a combined thing. Socio-economic factors affecting availability of land for agricultural purpose. Here, what this person is only requesting of you is only the economic aspects of it. And what are these economic factors that will affect our usage of land for agricultural purpose? One, for vocational purpose. It means that if they have to use, set our land aside to build vocational centers, it means that that land cannot be used for agricultural purpose. Residential purpose, we also use land to build our houses. It means that that land is not available for agricultural purpose. For commercial purpose, whether we use it to construct our banks, warehouse, and whatever commercial business centers that they built on this land, that type of land is not for agricultural purpose. Mineral exploitation, where they mine our mineral resources, it means that that land will also not be available for agricultural purpose. For recreation centers, where we enjoy, relax, and enjoy ourselves, that land is also not available for agricultural purpose. If you now look at all these points I've raised, for vocational, for commercial purpose, residential, and so on, they all bring economic benefits. So here, points like building of churches, mosques is out of it because that belongs to the social factor as it affects the availability of land for agricultural purpose. And the E part, these two each for farm machinery and implements. I'm also surprised there because only a few of you got that aspect right, that you cannot differentiate between what a machine is, what an implement is. But mind you, we should always remember that machine can work on its own. The implement, they have to be coupled to another machine before it can work. And what are these examples? For the farm machine, you have the milking machine, the incubator, the dryer, the baler, the tractor, the tripuller, the bulldozer. All these machines, as we have learned in our previous lesson, they can work on their own. But for the implement, they have to be attached. Majority of them has to be attached to the farm machine we call the tractor. And that's why the first person is saying that for mud puddler, it must a point of attachment, which is the inch. Now, the example of this implement will now be our plow, our harrow, our ridger, our knapsack sprayer, and so on. They are all implements that needs to be attached to another machine before you can perform their function. 2A now, that is question one. 2A, discuss the cultivation of cassava under the following heading. This comes from the crop production aspects. And the most popular question is this cassava. One, soil requirement. The type of soil cassava require is a wet, dry, feeble, loamy soil. Wet, dry, feeble, loamy soil. That means it is not so loose or it's not too sticky. Average, texture of this particular soil is what cassava is required for a successful cultivation. Two, the spacing. The spacing is just 1 meter by 1 meter. The in-between and the row, just 1 by 1 meter. One disease. We have some diseases that attack cassava plants. And we need just to mention only one of them. We have the first one, cassava mosaic disease, the bright, the cassava bacterial blight, and the leaf spots of cassava. These are the three important diseases that affect cassava. Any one of it you mention, you are covered. And the last one, pest. Only two pests affect cassava production. And that has to do with one, our variegated grasshopper, and two, the rodent. Variegated grasshopper, as we remember, attack the leaf. The rodents, they attack, the variegated grasshopper affects the leaves, while that of the rodent attack at the root level by tampering with the tuber under the soil. B part says differentiate between natural pasture and artificial pasture. This is also coming from the forage crop aspects, which has to do with studying the pasture crops. Now, what you should note here, as I've always been saying also, is that any question that asks you to differentiate, you should try as much as possible. In your answer, it must feature this conjunction, why, or you tabulate between the two concepts you have to differentiate between. But in some question will be specific by saying tabulate. Then you'll be marked down if you use the conjunction style of adding Y in between the two concepts that you are differentiating. So what I'm saying is that differentiate, this question has not been specific. You can either differentiate with the conjunction Y, or you put it in a tabular form. So what is the difference between the two? Natural pasture is a type of pasture crops that grows naturally on their own, and animal fed on it. While artificial pasture is grown and managed by the farmer for the livestock animal to feed on. Note here, the key word there is grown naturally. And here, man cultivates and manages these pasture crops. And I know we still remember those pasture crops. They are grasses and legumes. The deep part states Mendel's law of independent assessment of gene. Some of you state the law of segregation, and that is the first law of Mendel. This question is asking about the second law of Mendel, and does there as it has been stated by the Mendel himself. And how does he state it? Mendel states that the Mendel's law of independent assessment of gene states that each character behaves as a separate unit and they are inherited independently from one generation to another. I've always been saying, for you to get this law to be stated well, you don't need to cram. What you need to know, the independent assessment is talking about the character. The law of segregation is talking about that man development from the gene. But here, it means that, remember, that's why we did the diabetic crossing of looking at two characters together at the same time. That of the plant, where we look at the shape and the color of the plant. The shape is a character on its own. The color is a character on its own. The gene that controls that of the color will continue to be inherited, independent of that of the shape. And that's why it says that each character behaves as what? A separate unit. The E part explains the term regeneration as a forest management practice. We have also looked at different types of forest management practices, one of which is the regeneration as a method of forest management. And regeneration has to do with the regrowth of the forest after it has been exploited. They have removed all the forest trees and we want to bring up that forest back again. But majority of you are defining afforestation, which has to do with the practice of growing forest trees. The practice of growing forest trees, you are just about to establish a forest. So for regeneration to take place, this is that a forest forest has already been existing. The only thing that they have removed majority of these forest trees and want them to come back into a forest again, which, if you remember, is two ways, whether natural or artificial. When they cut the timber from the forest tree on its own, it grows back. As we know that when we remove some of branches of our crops at all, they have the tendency to spring up again. That is natural regeneration, if it has to do with forest management. And the second one, it means that man is going to aid the regrowth of this particular forest tree. So what I'm saying in essence is that regeneration as a forest management has to do with the regrowth, not the planting. Once the regrowth is not there and planting is there, your examiner assumes that what you are defining is afforestation. So be careful about keywords in every concept you are defining. And the last one, before we end the class, is saying five effects of deforestation. As I said, we have so many ways of managing our forest. Another one is the deforestation. Deforestation means that we are removing all the forest trees. We are wiping up that forest reserve area. And what are the effects? Number one is that it's going to reduce the quantity of rain formation, because we have said that forest trees contribute to the rainfall formation. Is going to lead to the reduction in the population of the forest fauna. That means those wild animals, when there is no shelter, no habitat for them, they will escape that particular forest area. It is going to reduce soil fertility. When those vegetation covers are not there again, it will prone the soil to lose its nutrients. And also, these forestry, when they are removed, it will lead to desert encroachment. Where there is no vegetation, sand is bound to accumulate in such area. That's why it pulled that area to the desert encroached area. It also increased the rate of soil erosion. Since the soil is dead, no cover, the soil will also be exposed to several agents of erosion. And with any of these, you are able to bring out, you score a full 5 marks for that particular point. And this year we'll call it a day for this particular class. And inshallah, we will employ you to check your portal to see some of the related questions to those areas of the topics these questions have come out. I employ you to go through them, make your response and forward, so that you can assess how far you have gone. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.